Okay, today's lab is called Dropping Out, and I want to talk a little bit about what our reactants are going to be today. One of the reactants we're going to use today is called it's Epsom salt, and another name for Epsom salt is magnesium sulfate. And its chemical formula is MgSO4, which means it has a magnesium atom, a sulfur atom, and four oxygen atoms that make up one molecule of magnesium sulfate. One of the other chemicals we're going to use today is ammonia. Ammonia is NH3, which means it has one atom of nitrogen and three atoms of hydrogen that make up one molecule of ammonia. We're also going to use water, just basically it's distilled water, and of course that's H2O, one molecule of hydrogen, I'm sorry, two molecules, or two hydrogen atoms and one oxygen atom to make up one molecule of water. Distilled water just means it's been basically purified. There's no contaminants or anything like that, no minerals that are really in it. And so it's just pure water, and it helps with our reactions and things. And the water essentially is just going to be to dissolve the salts, the Epsom salts, into the water so that we can get a solution to work with in our ammonia. And so what we're going to see today is that when we take these two solutions, when we take the ammonia and we take the Epsom salt that's been dissolved in water, they're both going to be clear liquids. And what we're going to find is that when you mix those clear liquids together, you end up with a precipitate. And basically, a precipitate, if you think of the word precipitation, we normally think of rain or snow. And so that means that there is moisture coming out of the sky. So in the same way, precipitate, when we're talking about chemistry, means we are taking basically two solutions or two liquid solutions, putting them together, and then we end up forming a solid substance out of it that does not dissolve in water or that does not easily dissolve. And so that's our challenge today, is to kind of see how we can form a precipitate by adding these two different compounds together. Now remember, we're dealing with reactants, which mean when we put them together in a solution, they're going to react immediately with each other. Some signs of reaction, of course, are bubbling, forming of a precipitate, which is what's going to happen today. Sometimes it's a change in temperature, whether it's an increase in temperature or a lowering of temperature. An increase in temperature means that it gives off energy in its breaking of the bonds and reforming of bonds as it forms new compounds, and that is called an exothermic reaction. If the temperature falls, then we call that an endothermic reaction because it takes in more energy than it gives off, and it actually causes the temperature to fall off. And that's also a rearrangement of atoms. Now remember, we're going to end up with some products today, so we're going to see what that product is at the end of our reaction and see what happens. So I'm going to get the camera a little bit re-stabilized and set up where we can kind of zoom up close to the lab table and see how we're going to go about doing this today, okay? Okay, my scale is set at zero and everything is calibrated right here. The two lines match up with each other. And so I know I'm ready to begin with my weighing or measuring of the mass of the substances I need today. So I'm going to go ahead and put my weigh boat on the scale, and I need to measure that out and get that straightened up. So usually they're about 2.2 or so. It's about what those weigh boats weigh. So let me kind of see if that balances out. That's pretty good. Okay, now I need 6 grams of Epsom salt. So right now I have 2.2. So if I add 6 to that, it's going to be 8.2. So I'm going to move my dial over here to 8.2. Now it falls down. So when I get 6 grams of Epsom salt on the scale, it's going to balance itself out. Okay, it's always easier if you start getting a little bit too much to just leave it on the scale and just kind of take away from it. It makes the massing the weight of this a little bit easier instead of taking it completely off the scale. And just understand, 6 grams is not a whole lot, so I'm not expecting to have a whole lot of stuff in here. Now remember, this is Epsom salt we're dealing with, which is magnesium sulfate. Move that back. Okay, let that kind of rest for a second. Okay, so that's about 6 grams right there. I'm also going to need 12 milliliters of ammonia. So I'm going to go ahead and measure that out. If you notice on this graduated cylinder, it starts at 5 on the big line and goes up to 10, 15, 20. So I've got to figure out what each line represents. Well, I've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 small lines between the 10 and the 15. Well, they can't be 1 or I'd be way past 15, right? So each little line that you see right here is going to be half a milliliter. So it's going to go 10, 10 and a half, 11, 11 and a half, 12, 12 and a half, 13, 13 and a half, 14, 14 and a half, and 15 milliliters. Well, I need 12. So I'm going to go 10, 10 and a half, 11, 11 and a half, 12. So that second large line that's after the 10 will give me 12 milliliters. I want to make sure it's on a flat surface. And remember, I want to read the bottom of the curved line. Now that curved line is called the meniscus. And so I want to make sure I get it in there. And when I start getting close, I'm going to stop squirting so much of it. Let it settle down a little bit. And I need to look at it from a level surface. So right there, the bottom of the curved line shows to be 12 milliliters. And that should be pretty accurate. Now, one thing I am missing here, I need a 100 milliliter beaker for this, for me to dissolve these things into. So I'm going to pause the video for just a second and grab that beaker, and then we'll start again. Okay, so I want to make some pre-observations with my reactants before we start. And one thing I want to notice is that the Epsom salt, or this magnesium sulfate, has pretty large grains. I don't know if you can tell by how they look on camera, but they're really large crystals kind of gathered together, and it's got a really grainy texture. Doesn't really have a smell, and I'm not going to taste it because we're not supposed to taste things in here, but it is white, it's a solid, it is granular, and it's got large grains. The ammonia, on the other hand, that we measure, is got a very strong odor. It irritates the nose. If you've ever smelled hair dye, or you smelt a glass cleaner that's real strong, you're smelling ammonia in that. And so ammonia is also, if you've ever smelt like a litter box that needed to be taken out from a cat that's really strong smelling, it's because there's a lot of ammonia in cat urine, and that really strong smell that you're smelling is the ammonia. And so if you're familiar with any of those smells, you kind of know what ammonia smells like. It rates right up there with a skunk as far as how strong it is, okay? A little bit different smelling, but it's still a very strong smell. And so we're going to take this 100 milliliter beaker, which I just picked up, and we need 50 milliliters of distilled water. So if you notice, it goes 20, then it's going to go up to 40, 60, 80, and 100. And so the halfway mark between 20 and 40 is 30, so it's going to go 20, 30, 40, 50, 60. I need 50 milliliters of water. So I'm going to go ahead and pour to that mark in my beaker. Right about there. And I'm going to take my magnesium sulfate, and I'm going to pour it in there. And I'm going to use the stirring rod. I'm going to stir that completely until it dissolves. I want it all dissolved. I don't want to see any of it. Okay, so I want a totally clear liquid. And what that does basically is, as I stir it, it causes the surface area to become more in contact with the liquid, so it starts dissolving it away. And you guys use dissolving quite a bit if you ever like put sugar in water or iced tea or Kool-Aid. All that is dissolving. And if you notice right now, it's kind of cloudy, which means that the substance is still in a solid state and needing to get stirred up and dissolved. And there's a couple ways you can actually cause this to go faster. You can heat it up and stir it, which will make it actually dissolve even quicker. But I really don't want to change the temperature of this, okay? Because I want to make sure that when it reacts, I want to be able to feel if there's a temperature change just by its normal setting. So it's looking pretty good. Not quite there yet. So I'm going to keep on stirring to get it all mixed up really good. Another way you can cause things to dissolve quicker is to smash them up, because that causes the surface area of the smaller particles inside to become exposed and causes it to really dissolve faster too. But we're making some headway here. Almost there. Okay, I want that to sit for just a second and see if there's any kind of particles at the bottom of the beaker. If it's totally dissolved, I'm not going to see any particles. And that's pretty much it. I don't know if you can tell from the camera angle, but it's completely clear. If I was to look at that, if I was sitting out on a table, it would look just like water. If I compare these two things together, they're pretty well identical to each other. Okay. Okay, now I also have the ammonia, which is clear. That's important to notice. So both items are clear. This one obviously has a large, a really bad smell. This one, no smell at all, really. It does smell a little bit like salt water. Like if you went to the ocean, it has that smell a little bit. So that's the only thing I really noticed. I think it's just because it's dissolved now into water. You didn't really notice it in the solid state. Definitely doesn't smell like ammonia. This one obviously does. Now what I'm going to do is take the ammonia and pour it into the beaker. And I don't want to touch it now. I just want it to sit there. So I'm going to give it about 5 minutes. I'm going to set my timer. And I'm going to let it run for about 5 minutes. And then we'll come back and look at it. Okay, so this is what it looks like 5 minutes after. At first, if you notice, it just was like a clear liquid because we took two clear liquids together and just kind of combined them together. Now we see this really foggy looking setting going on. And that just means that there's a reaction taking place, that the atoms of the two different compounds that we mixed together have actually disassociated or unbonded from each other, and they now rearrange themselves. And one of the products that's being created that you see here is basically a product that does not dissolve in water, and that's magnesium hydroxide. So what's happened now is, remember, the magnesium was originally attached to the sulfur and the oxygen. So the magnesium has basically separated itself, and now it has attached itself to the hydrogen atoms. And so now we have this cloudy substance that is a precipitate and is now not dissolved in water any longer. So it's basically created some new products. Now if I smell it, it's not near as strong as it was a minute ago with the ammonia. And so the ammonia is dissipating. Basically the ammonia is changing into something new as those atoms are rearranging themselves to create the magnesium hydroxide. So we're going to let this sit here for a couple hours now, and we'll come back and look at it and see what it looks like at that point, okay? Okay, this has been sitting here for a few hours, actually. I let it sit even longer. And if we notice, the substance at the bottom, this white area, is all the precipitate, the solid substance that has formed out of the liquid. And so if you notice, it's very clear at the top and has this little white layer down here, and that is all the magnesium hydroxide that has formed out of this. Now I could actually filter this off or evaporate the liquid contents out of this by heating it up and then getting all the substances down here at the bottom, and I'd have magnesium hydroxide, which was formed. And so quite a neat little reaction. So we had this was basically called falling out, which meant that when we add these two liquids together, we end up with a new substance that does not dissolve in water. And that new substance has none of the same properties as the original substances that we started with. Okay? So I hope you enjoyed this lab. It's got some interesting questions. The smell, by the way, is not near as strong. The ammonia is practically gone as far as the smell of it goes. And that's just basically because it has changed completely. So continue to watch this video. I'm going to have some pictures of the students that worked in this lab that follows this point.